Es basic Warhammer 40k objection expand from battle from Becky as well.
Hey all, this is part two in a two-part series on the Warhammer races. If you haven't seen part one yet, we do the Imperium of Man. And I highly recommend you watch that to get context for this episode. If you already have, go ahead and keep on watching. So after an entire episode of nothing but humans, we can now talk about chaos, which involves humans again. But a little bit less, we also got demons and shit.
I just felt someone grab my ass.
What?
Like hard, Nick.
So, as I've mentioned many times before, we've discussed the warp, the immaterium, the hellish landscape, the purgatory dimension realm between the material realm of our existence. Now, in the warp, it's terrifying, horrible, there are demons everywhere, things are crazy, all your minds and thoughts and emotions get projected there. It is both formless and empty, it is vast and tiny, it obeys the laws of time and physics while simultaneously does absolutely nothing of the sort. It is a hodgepodge and a culmination of just unknowable, eldritch, horrifying shit. And four gods that permeate in chaos and the warp. These are the four major chaos gods. And if we wish to learn about chaos, we need to learn about each and every single one of these chaos gods. First up, we have Khorne, and he is the easiest. Khorne is your classic Satan. He is all about anger, murder, fighting, blood, guts, death. You ever heard the term blood for the blood god, skulls for the skull throne? That's Korb. The whole idea is that he is all about the fury and strength of battle. He doesn't care where blood comes from, so long as blood is flowing. He wants to fight and murder and carnage and slaughter and death, 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 death. That is Korb. Very simple to understand. Next up, you have Tzeentch, and Tzeentch is the god of change. However, the god of change, it permeates in so many different other ways. He's the most eldritch of all the demon gods. He has this weird way to always be plucking at the strings of the universe. He's always conniving and scheming and doing his best to cause as much little bullshit as he can. Tzeentch is unknowable. Everything that makes sense, he will and won't do. Every future and setting and every type of destiny or fate is all foretold and also changeable. It is set in stone while also completely random. He knows what everything is going to happen and also that none of it's going to happen. You would ask Tzeentch a question. That question leads to three more questions. And those questions lead to the heat death of the universe, which asks four answers to those questions. And then he thinks to himself, what are questions even really? And are you even asking the questions? Or are you simply giving paths to answers?
Maybe this guy's high.
Other horseshit. Tzeentch is just, I'm gonna fuck with stuff. He is yes and he is no. He is the understanding and he is complexity. He is unknowable. And that's what the god of change is about. Very bizarre. He likes birds a lot.
Birds.
Next up we got Papa Nurgle. Papa Nurgle, he loves you for who you are. Probably not. He will murder you just the same. But Papa Nurgle is about rot, pestilence, death, and decay. He is the end of everything. Him and Tzeentch do not like each other very much because
Tzeentch
represents change and adjustment. Nurgle represents stagnation and death. He is all about miasma and pestilence and large bloat and pus and organs and people just being sedentary, sloth.
Oh boy.
He is the idea that everything will rot and decay and die. Nothing is certain besides decay and death. All of us will end up the same way and broken down through just sheer never-ending decomposition. So the joke that Nurgle always loves you is generally because of that, because we all end up the same. We all rot, and we all die and wither. That's Nurgle, and he's got a general theme of course, pestilence and different kinds of diseases and sickness and things of that nature. That's generally Nurgle. He's pretty easy to understand as well, and he chalk! Finally, we have the youngest of the Chaos Gods, and that is Slaanesh also known as the Prince of Pleasure,
God
of unspeakable excess. Slaanesh is generally referred to with sex. But it's not only sex, it's just that's a good avenue if you want to make stuff. Slaanesh is just the idea of the senses of the body being cranked to not just 11, but more like 17. See, we'll discuss Slaanesh a little bit more when we talk about the Eldar, because they done fucked up. But she, he, it, or whatever, is mainly about just the excess of emotions. And therefore, sex is generally a large part of it. However, it's mostly pain. And torture, lots of pain, torture, but sometimes sexually related or drug related, lots of drugs.
BDSM.
Slaanesh gets off on everything, extremes in happiness, extremes in sadness, extremes in pain and sadism and masochism. And of course that goes along with the sex part of it as well. It's generally referred to sex because of the color scheme, very purple, lots of exposed genitalia. A lot of their models have like exposed nipples and stuff. And that is generally the theme you go for from a physical side, but it really embodies everything. Mainly pain and also the excessive amounts of emotion. So when it comes down to it, you'll find a lot of them have things like spikes or whips or any kind of BDSM style gear, because it is unspeakable excess, the Prince of Pleasure. Everything in excess to the point where it is just sheer frightening. That is Slaanesh in a nutshell. A little bit bizarre and a little hard to describe sometimes, but as we talk more about the Dark Eldar layer in this video, you'll understand it far, far better and far more than you'd want to. They might be thinking, why would anyone ever want to join Chaos? They all look horrifying, screwed up, and just frightening things, right? Well, the thing is that, of course, one, your mind is put into the warp and the immaterium, so you can be easily swayed by Chaos demons when they get into your head, especially if you're a psychic. Sometimes regiments of the less immensely strong people, whether they be civilians or, say, low-level guardsmen or conscripts, can be easily swayed by this and become Chaos cultists and stuff, and they serve their dark gods or whatever god they personally refer. However, and this might seem strange, Chaos in their own right isn't necessarily evil. See, the warp is every manifestation of emotion and being, every soul, everything of existence. This includes all the good things. All the different Chaos gods have another side to their coin. Khorne might be death, murder, slaughter, but he's also got this weird sense of survival of the fittest, trial by combat, and honor. Khorne will never lie to you. Khorne will never stab you in the back. Khorne isn't about conniving and scheming. Khorne is about straight up mano-e-mano. You
versus
me, get in the ring, we're gonna murder each other hard right now. It may not be a good thing at the end of the day, but it is that other side of the coin. Him and Zeech generally don't get along because Zeech is that conniving schemer, but he's also about the idea of hope. Where there is change, there is change for your predicament. There is change for your problem. The hope of the galaxy, the ability to bend the world to your will, the idea that your fate is not set in stone, but in reality that you control your own destiny and can control whatever you want, the changer of ways. That is Zeech. And of course, Zeech and Nurgle hate each other, because while Nurgle does represent stagnation, death, and decay, he also represents finality. An ending. The fact that you can be mentally at peace knowing that you will end and how you will end. Fear of the unknown, fear of change is not present with Nurgle. With Nurgle, everything will rot and die, and that provides that finality, that ability that this is over. We are all the same, and we will all end the same. We know the meaning of life. The meaning of life is to live and die and rot. And with that, it brings peace of mind. Slaanesh is a lot more simple. While they are the excess of emotion, they are also the representation of emotion. Slaanesh embodies happiness. Slaanesh embodies excitement and joy and pleasure, not only in the sense of the physical, you know, bam, style of pleasure, but also everything else like food and drink. And air on your cheek and sunlight, the feeling, emotion and feeling, all of that is also represented with Slaanesh. So you have to ask, why are they always represented as super evil skulls and spikes on everything and want to murder everybody? I don't really got an answer for you on that one. My assumption is that because mentally humans may think worse thoughts, even if we don't act on them, and therefore they're projected in the warp more. That one's a little bit weird. I don't know. This is me spitballing right now, but I don't know. You need a,
kind of makes sense.
Bad guy. You already got the Imperium of Man. You need somebody to be a little bit worse than them. So you got demons. Honestly, who cares? I just want to buy like a bird magician. Look at him. So cool. So combining all this together on the tabletop, Chaos Demons are generally very melee based. They run in, go really hard. You have lots of summoning and conjuring, tons of spells. Generally a little bit frail, but they have special saves to make them a little bit stronger. You've got giant demons and smaller demons. You got hordes of little boys and tons of big guys. Demons are, as they see, demons. Nurgle is slow. Khorne is super scary in melee. You've got Zeech, who are far more into psychers and spell casting. And then Slaanesh, who is all melee. Really fast, but squishy, but in lots of hordes of tons of melee and pain damage, of course. So overall, the demons are a huge part of 40K and a massive threat to almost every single faction, with the exception of a couple. However, the big part about demons is also transferred into the other nine Primarchs we didn't talk about, which are the Chaos Space Marines.